Show here on Shadow Talk Radio Network. I promise you, William, I have kicked the computer and I think it's going to behave now. William, we're on.
Okay, we are back, and Mike, what's going on is that I can only hear the commercial breaks through the website, and I'm not getting anything from our phone lines. I can't hear any of the music or the commercials on the phone line, and so I was not able to get hear your cues. So we'll continue to work on that. But I was telling Miss Godfrey, our guest, that some nights when we talk about something paranormal or something that is potentially paranormal, we have a gremlin attack. They get into the inner workings of our communication systems and our computer systems, and they just have a hullabaloo. And
I'm hoping that Linda is going to stick around for the post game show, because I got a story to tell you about Wednesday night's show.
Okay, excellent.
All right.
So I'm hoping, Ms. Godfrey, are you on the line with us?
Yes, I'm here.
Very good. See, and it's not affecting you on your end, so that proves that we are the unwitting recipients of this appalling attack.
I think we have them worried. Shadow Talk Network is on the air, and they're worried.
They're worried because we mean business, and we walk softly and carry a big stick, and we're not playing. Mike actually sent me a question about the history of these sightings, Linda. Now, aside from the 1936 Shackleman report, Do we know anything prior to that, or is everything Native American leading up to that, or what?
Well, there are various reports that we have from early newspapers from settlers who saw different sorts of creatures, and sometimes they, of course, really had texts for these things, and sometimes they would call them wild men. Sometimes I think they were probably seeing a Bigfoot. Their descriptions sound like Bigfoot, they'll describe ears and a muzzle, really more canid sounding. But they're sort of sketchy and few and far between. The very early newspapers with settlers were, the newsprint was expensive. They didn't have a lot of space to spend on stories like this. And then when you get up into around the 1900s, you get a lot more stories to go by. However, in those times, newspapers were kind of running wild, and every little town had three or four newspapers. And it's well known to us now that many of those newspapers would print wildly speculative stories or totally invented things just to sell more newspapers that day. So you have to really look at
Are
those with
you
a grain of salt.
insinuating that a newspaper would just make stuff up just to sell papers?
Oh,
That's an outrageous charge.
I think that it did used to occur, but there are reports that are credible, and I not that I can relate particularly to the Beast of Bray Road, but in many locations of the world. And you can also go back to many of the European stories. For instance, back in the 1300s, 1400s, 1500s, when you were having the European witch trials, many of these trials were inseparable from werewolf trials. And if you were accused of being a werewolf, you were a witch, would therefore be burned at the stake. And people of those days literally did all believe in werewolves. And they weren't like Hollywood. Most of the ideas we have about werewolf lore today come from those early Hollywood 1930s, 40s movies. But they really did believe in those days that witches could take the form of wolves, and that they would do this to get power. They would be cannibalistic, that sort of thing. So where did those come from? Were those based on possible sightings of real creatures? I'm not sure. It does make you wonder if there was something like that. They had a very dense natural wolf population in Europe in those days. You had a
You know,
lot of encounters. Pardon?
I've also read that in Europe it is possible that some species of well, what we would call prehistoric wolves survived much later than was commonly believed, and these creatures may have been, seen by the local townsfolk, etc. These wolves would have been much, much larger than the standard wolf, or the, quote, modern wolf, and would have really come off as a monster. And of course, these are all kinds of theories and speculations that you can kind of add into the mix here. We know for sure that there are animals that we come across from time to time that we thought were extinct, and it's and then one pops up and is, oh, they're not extinct,
Right,
and
like the
this may have
coelacanth.
been the case. Coelacanth, perfect example. And in the wilder parts of Europe, with the dense forests and the very expansive wilderness, in Europe of old, it's not out of the question.
Well, that's true, and there also are the old pagan rituals that come out of places like the Vikings, who had their berserkers, which
Oh,
were
yes.
soldiers that would wear bear skins or wolf skins out into battle, and that would sort of take on the characteristics of the animal, hoping to scare their enemies by their ferocious appearance. But then it sort of went beyond that and got to where people were claiming that the berserkers actually metamorphosed into wolves and bears and became shapeshifters of a sort. And you have to wonder whether, I don't know if this is possible and true or not, but maybe that did happen, and there was some sort of shamanic psychic ability that was able to cloak itself in an astral werewolf figure that people would see and remember, or whether they were just imitating a natural wolf that they had seen that did walk upright. Maybe this was a trait that was more common and adaptive than we know about, and that the shamans were imitating something that they had seen in nature. So,
did you ever read hear of the case of the man named Bill Ramsey?
Yes.
That was a case that was, of course, investigated by the legendary paranormal researchers Ed and Lorraine Warren.
Right, and I do discuss that in Hunting the American Werewolf.
Right, and it's a fascinating case because it moves over more into our traditional concept of werewolves, where you have a man who is actually undergoing some kind of weird transformation.
Except he never really did. You know, he doesn't. His legs never lock into the backward position. He doesn't really sprout fur. The thing was, he could sort of gnarl and twist his fingers so that it looked like they were turning claw-like. But, you know, if you've got some nice knobby fingers and you let your nails go really long, you can see where that can happen. But he never, at any point, looked at anything other than a very wild and deranged man. And we've had other people, even right on Bray Road, there it's been known that a person who doesn't always take his medicine like he should will occasionally believe that he is the Beast of Bray Road. And families have called into 911 and said, hey, we're driving down Bray Road and this naked man leaped on the windshield of our car. But notice, they never say that a werewolf leaped on the windshield of our car. They say that a naked man, it just looks like a very weird naked man. And that's the thing with even people will suggest the old, I don't know if you've heard of the ergot explanation. Ergot is a fungus that grows on rye, which can cause hallucinations and all kinds of strange and crazy behavior. And it was rampant in Europe in the Middle Ages because peasants ate rye and storage methods were horrible, and so it would often rot and have this mold and cause many strange things. However, it never made them grow ears on top of their head or fur all over their bodies or a muzzle, you know, and things, things that would make them look like a werewolf. So even people who are born with hair all over their bodies, they still look like very hairy humans. They don't have pronounced muzzles. They don't have fangs. They're not turning into dogs. They're just humans with an excess of human hair.
Yeah, and I was about to say, you know, we all know that, you know, there these conditions, you know, are out there. We all know that lycanthropia is a real mental disorder, a clinical disorder. We all know that, you know, there are disturbed people out in the world, et cetera. But we also need to understand that none of those things can really fully account for, you know, for example, some of the sightings that we're talking about tonight. You know, this idea of this kind of mass hysteria that suggests that, you know, if you have that many people out in the public that are, you know, kind of cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, if you will, then we have a much bigger problem than a man wolf lurking around. But that gets me to, I guess, an absurd aspect, if you will. Sci-Fi Channel, a few years ago, I don't know what year it is now, what year the movie came out, but Sci-Fi Channel did a movie called The Beast of Bray Road.
That's And I'm sorry.
and exactly. And I remember that when they were promoting the movie, I remember thinking, oh, okay, they made a film out of the book.
Not really, no.
And well, exactly. And of course, so I was front and center to watch the film. And this movie was the only correlation between that movie and the book was the title. Seriously, and the movie was so bad that you were compelled to watch it. Okay. And no, seriously, and I actually recommend folks out there, if you haven't seen it, I know they run it on the Sci-Fi Channel fairly regularly, and it's probably on DVD somewhere, but it's actually worth watching for that purpose. It has very little connection to your books and your research. Can you talk about it a little bit, Linda? Uh-oh. I think we lost Linda again, so we'll try to get her back.
Hello?
I think it's the Sci-Fi Channel that's jamming us now. I was just going to ask you.
Pardon?
I know. Go ahead and make a comment, but I wanted you to just comment on your thoughts on the film and all that.
Well, you know, they used my title. They took the title, The Beast of Bray Road, and they sort of took the premise. You know, there's some sort of beast, but they had it really killing and mangling people, which, if you've been listening, has never happened. Mm-hmm. And, you know, took a lot of liberties with how they portrayed the people of my hometown, you know, that kind of thing. So, I had nothing to do with it, absolutely nothing at all to do with it. And I guess I don't really mind because it seems like I sell more books every time Sci-Fi runs that movie.
Okay.
But I really did not have anything to do with it, and people should not expect to watch the movie and find out what's in the book because they're two completely different things.
Right, and like I said, yeah, it is graphic, and there is a great deal of murder and mayhem in the movie. But you find yourself, you know, the first 10 or 15 minutes, you're kind of rolling your eyes, and then you say, I better watch this to the end. Just to make sure that, you know, I saw what I thought I saw. it is, you know, folks, it's not connected to the book. It's not connected to Linda. But it is the Beast of Bray Road. So, Linda, you said earlier that you still get reports sometimes 3, 4, 5 a week.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So this is... you know, because some people might think, well, you know, we've got these books and, you know, are there folks up there actively researching, you know, because like we always know that there are folks all over doing Bigfoot research, for example, kind of going into the wilderness, looking for Bigfoot, kind of traipsing through the forest. And I was very surprised that, you know, the program Monster Quest, which is kind of popular show. I'm surprised they've never touched on this or maybe they will get to it. Oh, they haven't done a show on it? Okay.
Yeah, there's a show titled American Werewolf that is based on my book, Hunting the American Werewolf. Mm-hmm. And I not only appear in it as one of their testifiers, but I wrote the original script for them and have associate producer credits and worked very hard with them on this show. Yeah. And again, it's based on Hunting the American Werewolf.
I didn't see that episode. Did they do a fair representation? You know, sometimes when you do these shows.
They did. Well, partly, you know, it did help being able to, although they changed the script, at least I had the first lick at it. But what we did was they had me round up as many witnesses that I could get a hold of that were still in the area. They do tend to move away, you know, after... Uh-huh. after many years. But I had eight or nine, I think, witnesses, and some of them were husband and wife combinations. And we hooked them up with one of the leading polygraph experts in the Midwest.
Oh.
And every single one of them passed the polygraph test with flying colors.
Oh, boy.
We even had more that passed it than we could fit into the airtime.
You know, it's interesting. Well, anytime you do any kind of investigation into the unknown or into the paranormal, this is something that comes up from time to time. The number of witnesses that take and pass the polygraph test is an inordinate number. And, you know, it just, you know, skeptics always talk about, oh, there's no evidence. There's no evidence. Well, you know, here is a piece of evidence. Now, I don't know, are polygraphs still not permitted in a court of law? Is or I don't want to be Perry Mason here, but.
I'm not sure, you know, if they are everywhere, but I know they are some places. And
yeah, I know that the police use them.
Yeah, they're very much used tool, and the particular gentleman that we had hired out to different police forces all over.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that's very much used as a tool in law enforcement. And frankly, the producers did not believe that all of these witnesses were going to pass it. They especially had their doubts about a couple of them, and were shocked when there was absolutely no deception indicated.
Huh. Well, you know. The thing about a polygraph test is it only leaves you with a couple of conclusions. I mean, either all of these witnesses possess the mental faculties to fool the machine, you know, and I know that every now and then there's a person that, you know, one in a million that has that ability.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, your average everyday person is the machine is going to register accurately. And I've heard polygraph experts say that it's like 98% reliable. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you're left with is that these people saw what they claim to have seen.
Yeah. You know, that's what I believe. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you heard that little ding in the background, but that was another beast report that just came in over my computer. You know, another person.
Really?
So, yeah, it's just they keep coming. And, you know, once in a while I can identify someone that I think is pulling my leg. And
yeah.
after working for a newspaper for 10 years and interviewing 1 to 3 people a week for 10 years, that's a lot of people. You get a sense of who is doing that and who's being honest with you.
Well, typically, I'm always fascinated by this. If you get a person who is just messing around and just wasting your time, is it always just because – are these just people who want attention? They think they might get their names in the paper, or are they people who are trying to discredit you, or what are they doing?
Well, so far, you know, and I'm sure it could happen that there's maybe someone who wants to try and discredit me. It hasn't really happened too much, but – for the most part, they're people who are eager to see themselves get some attention, you know, who want to be a discoverer, who are usually very overly eager, you know, volunteering to go be on TV or whatever. Or there are other little things that, you know, tend to give them away to me. It's I don't want to describe them all, but generally I like to talk at length to people, or at least, you know, get several emails. Sometimes people only want to communicate by email, and even then there are things that are giveaways, you know.
Right.
So I do still try and keep my reporter hat on when I do receive these reports.
Right, because, you know, today, you know, everyone's on the internet, and, you know, people read these stories, and you know, it's very easy to say, well, you know what, I saw the Beast of Bray Road, and I'm gonna send her an email, and she's gonna interview me, and I might end up on TV, and you know, all these kind of things. And so, yeah, you do have to be careful because, I know that, when a hoax occurs, the debunkers will take the hoax as proof that none of it is real.
Right. Yeah. And
Yeah.
that's it's they're grasping at something to disprove it, and to them one hoax equals everybody being hoaxed. And it makes the honest witnesses very angry. They feel that people are sort of betraying them by trying to make them seem like they're liars when they're not.
Right. I mean, it's human nature. None of us, no one wants to be identified publicly as either a liar or crazy.
Right.
Nobody wants that.
No.
And so it is difficult for the people who are having legitimate sightings. So, Linda, we focused on these two books, Beast of Bray Road and Hunting the American Werewolf. Can folks get these books on your website or Amazon, or are they still in print?
Yes. Oh, they're all still in print. And if you go to my website, Beast of www. BeastofBrayRoad, BrayRoad.com. You can click on the book page, and there you'll see them listed. And you there's either a link for Amazon, or you can order them from me directly if you want them signed and autographed.
Oh.
They're also at BarnesandNoble.com carries them. So do many other online bookstores, and they're not hard to find. And I also have Weird Wisconsin, Weird Michigan, Strange Wisconsin, Strange Michigan, that have many additional strange creature stories that people who are interested in these may like. And then with the Chelsea House series, there's werewolves. I did another one on lake and sea monsters.
Oh.
We have weird things in the water as well.
So you guys are not content with just having this werewolf up there.
No, we have to have it all.
Right. You got monsters in the water, et cetera.
That's right.
So now, is there anything else upcoming? Now, those books you mentioned, are they already done, or are they
Yes.
in the pipeline now, or do you have what's coming up?
No, those books are already out. I have a third one from Chelsea House called Mythical Creatures that's coming out in late July. And I'm working right now on the third actual Beast series books. It'll be titled something like True Encounters
Okay.
with a Beast Man, because there are just so many more stories. I'm hoping that will be out by fall. And I'm also working on a book of Wisconsin haunting stories.
Oh,
So I
okay.
have a couple of things going. And I also have, I'm currently seeking a publisher right now for a novel about a German gnome called a kobold that migrates to the United States and encounters all these sorts of creatures. And I've been able to incorporate a lot of my creature lore that I've researched over the years into it.
Oh, wow. A gnome. Wow.
Yeah,
Who's
and the story is called
encountering
the
other
Kobold.
creatures.
Yeah, exactly. And it's called the Kobold, and I hope that's it's complete. I'm hoping that it'll be out sometime soon.
We'll look forward to that, and we'll try to get you back on so that we can hype that appropriately.
Thank
Ladies and
you.
gentlemen, we have come up against the end of the program. It's always like that. When you have a fascinating topic and an interesting guest, technical issues notwithstanding. But like I've said before, when you and it happens time after time, when we have something that's paranormal, we come under fire, but we weather the storm. But nevertheless, my guest has been Miss Linda Godfrey. Again, she is the author of The Beast of Bray Road, Tailing Wisconsin's Werewolf, and Hunting the American Werewolf. And it's been the topic of our conversation tonight. Now, Miss Godfrey, what I'd like to ask you to do is to hold on the line until we're off the air, so I can have a word or two with you and the producer
Sure.
off the air, what we call the post-game show. But for the rest of you, ladies and gentlemen, we will be here at this same time, same place, next week for more interesting and thought-provoking conversations. You will not hear the Outer Limits. You will not hear the Twilight Zone. It will be the Dr. William Lester Show. Good night and happy Easter.